introduction to the API management, the domain, and set the stage. API management is nothing new to anybody right now. It's a very ubiquitous term. Everybody has APIs. Everybody knows about APIs. At some point, you have done a lot of work on creating services and exposing those services as probably SOAP services in the service-oriented architecture paradigms, and then now you want to expose them as APIs. You have come a long way with it. You have API managers, gateways, ESBs, et cetera. What I wanted to talk about today is the market or the demand for API is very much different now. It is very much consumer driven. So this picture, I was actually wanting to put some screenshots because once I was shopping with my wife, we were actually going to a grocery store, and she suddenly got a alert in her mobile and said, "Hey, there's a sale in the other shop. Some cool stuff going on." So I asked, "How do you know?" I got an alert. So I asked, "How do you know that that other shop has that sale?" So she said, "I don't know. I got this alert." So I figured, okay, that means that store is tracking her location, and okay, she got an alert. So I asked her, "Do you know that that store is tracking your location?" "Oh, I don't care. I get that information." So that is the state of consumers right now. People, for IT folks like us, it is very sensitive. We don't like people tracking us. But an average person, it's not really, you know, you don't care much if you are getting a really good service, right? So, so there's a very interesting the documentary of Edward Snowden that I watched, that he's having a chat with his girlfriend, and he's saying that government is tracking you, and she's saying, "I don't have anything to hide." So he's saying that's such a BS idea, right? But that is the reality of average person, and in a sense, in some cases, it is okay if you are getting a really good quality service and you are not doing harm. It's a lot of debate, but in some sense, businesses can do that, and you are giving a good quality service. So these screenshots that you see, some of these websites, they provide a good quality service. I wanted to buy a jacket during the winter, and I shopped online, and the preferred store didn't have that jacket. So, and then I searched like a 50-mile area, which store has that jacket. So that kind of integration is there right now. So it's amazing, like all their production lines, all their inventories, everything is available right now. So, and it is integrated to their mobile app, their website, everything. So it is more consumer driven, like people demand things, it is easier, and you get a better sale out of it. So that's what, there's a term with Forrester that they say, okay, it's the age of the consumer. Earlier it was the age of the manufacturing, age of distribution, age of information, but now it's age of the consumer. Consumer decides how you want to do your business. So I think that's where every business wants to be right now. A very good example is Amazon right now. It's almost like Amazon is stalking us, right? You have Amazon website, which is the age-old thing. You have Amazon mobile application. If you are using a mobile, if you want to browse a book or something like that, you can go and check the mobile application. If you're reading through Kindle, and if you want to get a book, it is integrated there. So it's almost there. And then you have Alexa. If you are doing something, if you're cooking or something like that, you can just ask Alexa to order something. It's then and there, it's ordered, right? And then you have IoT stuff like the dash buttons, where you can put it into your washing machine or somewhere like that, and you can order your washing machine liquids, etc. So it is very, very convenient. You don't have to go to the laptop and order your stuff anymore, right? It's everything is right there. It's very, very convenient. The convenience is the thing that drives right these days. So every business, every enterprise wants to get into this business. And interestingly, large organization, large companies like Amazon, they build a platform. So other small companies or other smaller businesses, they can leverage this very, very easily. Starbucks, like when I go out from my my home, and if I want to get a coffee, I can tell Alexa, order my coffee. And Starbucks has all my preferences. I don't have to do anything. I just tell Alexa to order my coffee, and when I go to Starbucks, my coffee is there, right? So what Starbucks has done is they have used their Amazon APIs, Alexa APIs, integrated to their platform, deploy the application, and it's available for us, right? So that's the power of it. Okay, so I don't mean to disrespect the business here, but this is a very common term. Business is short-sighted. What do we mean by this? Is it a bad thing, or is it something that we need to understand better, right? As a typical engineer or a person who's coming from engineering background, you sometimes really, you know, you don't like that the business doesn't think about the right architecture, the nice architecture, the correct architecture, the highly scalable architecture, right? Business doesn't care, or it's more or less, business doesn't understand it. What business understands is generating value, getting the best thing out of there for their consumer, right? Often they don't know that best thing has a very complex architecture, very complex deployment, a very high level of availability. Business doesn't know that. What they want is the best experience to the customer with the lowest investment and as fast as possible, right? So that's the demand. And often, almost all the customers that I talk with, so when I meet them in the beginning of the year, they say, we don't know what the budgets will be like for this year, for this current year. Almost all customers or almost all teams compete for budgets, compete for creating a new project. So they want to, allocate a good chunk of money to do that really loved project in the most in the best way that they want to or they can. So that is what I meant by business is short-sighted. It is not a bad thing. It is just we as technical people needs to understand the business better, and create a value and give the business what they want, and in turn you can, you know, get them to understand what we are doing, how we are doing it, and what is at stake if we don't do it really nice. So there's a very common term called tech debt, right? When you think about short-term releases and putting something faster, you do a lot of trade-offs. That is tech debt, right? At some point, you need to pay that debt. So if you win the business, you will have time to, you know, pay that debt. And with that, I think this minimum viable product concept is, it is coined with this startup culture and everything. I think it's with venture capitals, like giving money for startups, and then they need to pitch something out as a minimum viable product, the MVP. But I think this is a really good idea for an enterprise as well when they work with the business with tight budgets, right? What they want to get out or put out is a minimum viable product. It has to be viable, that's number one. It can be the minimum thing that the business wants to take it out there to the consumer and get the traction. Because they don't want to build a huge project for 1 year of time, like a waterfall thing, and ultimately go out and give that trial to the customer. They want to put something out very fast. So the MVP model for the enterprise works really well. All right, so we talked about what business wants. We talked about the MVP. To do all these things, I believe the organizations, the companies, needs to be very, very flexible. So yesterday's keynote, we listened about the Agile Enterprise. So I think that's it's a very good thing to be flexible. So we can build something very quickly. We can have a very small team and build something quickly and get that out, right? So in Amazon, there's a idea of a team cannot be bigger than a pizza that you can share, right? So if your team cannot share one pizza, that team is too big, right? So the teams needs to be small, and they need to be very, very efficient. So that's pretty much the idea. So enterprise thrive to be more adaptive. They want to bring more change because the IT landscape or the technological landscape is very rapidly changing, right? So we worked with virtual machines, we now work with containers and container management clusters, et cetera, et cetera. Enterprises want to bring these changes, these good changes, and to bring these good changes, they need to be very flexible. They understand that the market needs changes by the day because consumers drive the demand, or it's an age of the consumer. So business needs to understand that if they don't have an application or something for Snapchat or something like that, maybe they are failing in some sense, right? So they need to address that segment, that business, etc. Organizations have to also enable organic growth. They can't artificially do things, right? In the keynote talk that we listened, how West brought change to their teams, how they created a maturity level for each team. They identified there are different teams. Some teams are faster, some teams are not so fast. There are medium-sized teams, medium efficiency team, and each team has their own model of working. So that's one thing that you need to have that change in organic way. You can't artificially do things because people won't like it. You need your employees, you need your people to love what they do, right? And the final thing is all these new challenges will definitely open new opportunities. So that's a good thing, right? That's a good thing out of all these changes, all this hardship. It opens up new challenges, new opportunities. Right, so yeah, it's really nice. Like, you need to build a very agile enterprise, you need to put up MVP product out, et cetera, et cetera. But the reality is, enterprise systems are quite complex, right? If you think about healthcare systems, if you think about airline systems, if you think about banking systems, these systems are not like they came from, like, they don't have like a 5-year history or something. Like, they have like hundreds of years of history, 100 years of baggage, 100 years of tech debt. Sometimes they have paid it, sometimes they have to pay it, and there are a lot of complexities. These systems are bureaucratic. They need to comply for the standards. If it's healthcare, they can't do things fast as maybe banking do. Banking is doing. Banking has their own set of standards. Airline systems, they have their own set of standards. So it's not easy. Like, for me to say you need to make agile company, it's easy for me to say it. But really to build that culture in a bureaucratic environment, it's not easy. So you need to bring those changes slowly to the enterprise, et cetera. And they can't afford the luxury of rewrite, right? They can't start with a green field and build everything and then push it to the customer, because you need to put out everything now, kind of a thing. And as I said, they comes with years of baggage. So with that, how I see it is, it's always a sliding window. There's a sliding window in enterprise architecture. You have mainframes, you have distributed systems with monoliths and service-oriented architecture. Now you have cloud servers with monoliths, SOA, and microservices. But it is not like a clear-cut separation. It's always a sliding window, right? When you have microservices, you still have mainframes as well. So you need to focus on your legacies, how to take your legacy systems out, and how to leverage your legacy systems in the modern APIs, modern applications, et cetera. So you need to think about that. All right. So now we come to the technical aspect of it. Everybody in this room have experience with service-oriented architecture. It's a really good concept when it comes to services, how you want to connect services together, how you want to make things platform independent, technology independent, vendor independent, how things needs to be driven by standards and not by programming languages or SDKs, et cetera, right? SOA defines those standards. In fact, WSO2 started as an SOA company. We created Apache Web Services project and donated to Apache. So we have come a long way from those standards. And if you look at it, there were a lot of promises from SOA. SOA said, okay, if you build with these qualities, you'll have a really nice flexible architecture. That is the promise of SOA. But if you think about it, the microservices architecture really delivers the promise of SOA. I personally don't think microservices as it's a very new kind of a thing. It's I think the service-oriented architecture done right, in the right way with the right types of tools. So if you look at these two columns, in the microservices, you can see modeled around business domain, culture of automation, hide the implementation details, decentralize all things, deploy independently, consumer first, highly observable. So these are not new things, right? We knew this 5 years ago, 10 years ago, we knew this in the first SOA book we read. We got this, we grasped these ideas. So the red color column is the SOA, the principles of SOA. So they are very, very common, very, very similar. So you can almost associate all these things together, right? So how we should look at it is, now the IT or technology landscape is very, very rich. We can do automation really well, right? We have Puppet, we have Chef, different kind of tools that can do really good level of automation. We have containerization, very, very lean, very, very minimalistic. You can get something up and running very quickly, right? So that's the good part of it. So things like getting something loosely coupled, which is a concept in service-oriented architecture, is very easy in the modern, in today. So that's a good thing. So if you want to have a container cluster today in Amazon, you can use Amazon Container Services. If you want to have your own container cluster, you can have Kubernetes and do it. It hides all the complexities, which was not a luxury 10 years ago. It hides all the complexities and gives you a nice interface to work on your business problem. That's a good thing about it. Right. So, and the other thing is, with the service-oriented architecture, ESB played a big role. ESB almost became the central thing, right? When you have a lot of services, you connect all those services to the ESB. You did compositions, you did orchestrations, everything in the ESB. I have worked with some customers, some organizations. They believe that any service that they write needs to go through the ESB because they can have really good control over that, which is a very good thing. They can have that policy. But now, when it comes to microservices kind of architectures, ESB is not playing the central role. ESB is more of an integration component or a service integrator. So in this diagram is coming from Gartner. What you can see is here, the ESB is pushed to a lower layer where you have a bunch of services and the ESB is working as an integrator. Or it calls multiple services and integrate those services and provide you a composite service, right? So it's not a very central thing in the pitch anymore. The API gateway has earned its place, right? So the API gateway, or we can call it the services gateway, it doesn't have to be a API itself. You can have multiple service gateways. Right now, the role the ESB played in terms of cataloging or indexing all services, exposing all services, or getting that central control is delegated to the service gateway. Right now, the service gateway do that better than the ESB did 5 years ago. So the complexities with the ESB architecture is ESB didn't have its own associated governance story. You had technologies like UDDI to discover services, which is a very, very difficult way of discovering services. With API, you have a very nice landscape of API governance. You have an app store, you can now search APIs, it is properly documented, test the API, et cetera, right? So the services gateway is much more convenient now, and it can play a very good role in the enterprise architecture. You still have the ESB. So there's this term called no ESB architecture. I don't really believe in that. I don't think any serious enterprise architecture or any complex enterprise enterprise can have a no ESB scenario. Because we talked about the sliding window paradigm, right? There's always legacy systems. So if there's legacy systems, if there's different types of data formats, if different types of data protocols are there, you definitely will have to integrate. You definitely will have to do some orchestration, composition, et cetera. So ESB will play a vital role. And then it also combines with the service gateway to expose them as services. So that's one reason we created Ballerina. So Ballerina can act as a service integrator for multiple microservices. So if you are creating, let's say, 10 microservices, and all those microservices can do like a loosely coupled business implementation, the Ballerina script can do that orchestration or that dance. It can pass the messages, do the composition, et cetera. So there's a really good article written by Kasun Industry, who's one of our integration architects. I took this diagram from that article. It talks about microservices architecture, how we realize it with our experience. It's not a very high-level document about theory kind of a thing. It's a practical article. There's a link in the slide deck. You can refer that. Right. So earlier it was all XML, SOAP, and WS security, WS reliable messaging kind of specification. But now increasingly, REST, JSON, Swagger is becoming the new normal. Security is very comprehensive now with RESTful way of doing things. You have OpenID Connect, OAuth, signatures, encryption, everything which is compatible with RESTful way of doing things. 5 years ago, people like REST. REST is lightweight. But if you are serious about creating RESTful interfaces, you can't really do it because you don't have the strength of WS security. You can't do encryption, you can't do signing and encryption, all that kind of things. But now the landscape is very much different. The security is really delivering its promise on the API landscape. API documentation for discovery is standardized more towards Swagger. There was debates with Swagger, RAML, et cetera, about seems Swagger is winning that race. It's more towards standardized. And there are a lot of like wide language frameworks support like MSF4J from WSO2, Spark, Spring Boot, et cetera, that will provide you a very clean interface to write microservices and create RESTful services, expose JSON, and create Swagger documentation out of it. All right, so what this picture shows you is that how we developed APIs before and how we should do API development now. API always comes first, right? So in Nuwan's, in our next talk, we'll show you how you do mock APIs, et cetera. But earlier, like if you look at this diagram in the left-hand side, you see 1, 2, and 3. You start with the implementation, then you create the API, then your applications use those APIs to build something. The problem with it is this is something like a waterfall kind of a model, right? You have to have the backend implementation, and then only you can your application developers use those APIs to create applications. But it shouldn't be the case. You can see now API comes first. You have to create the API definition. You can mock it easily. Any modern gateway, any modern service gateway should have this facility to mock that API. So what you do is you define the contract. You mock that. Basically, you create a JSON payload and put it in the gateway, and that will be thrown out of the API. Then your front-end team is not blocked. They can easily create their applications with the mock implementation. They don't know the back-end is not available. They simply get data. Their application works. Your back-end team simultaneously can work on the implementation. They can remove those mock APIs and then put the real backends. So APIs always comes first, and this is the way you should be implementing if you are going towards that. And APIs always comes at every layer. It's not like you have one API that you need to consume and you need to give to your UI teams or external partners, et cetera, et cetera. APIs are there at every layer. There are infrastructure APIs to scale your deployment, to create containers, et cetera. There are data APIs, that master data, historical data, all the summarized information that you can pick up. There's application APIs that comes from ERP systems, CRM systems, et cetera. Business APIs, as well as user experience APIs. So it's not one API, and it doesn't have to be one API gateway even. You can have your own services gateways for these domain-specific APIs. It's up to you to decide how you want to design that. But yeah, APIs come at every layer. Right. So we also talk about the solutions architecture. So when I mostly visit WSO2 customers, we do things like a thing called solutions architecture and deployment architecture. The solutions architecture is once we discuss all the requirements, we put together a diagram. Okay, this will look like your first cut of your production. These are the pieces you want. These are the existing pieces you have. This is the way that this will integrate and communicate. Right? And how we want to do it is we should make it iterative. That's why we are doing architecture reviews continuously. It is not like one architecture when you define the architecture, it's done deal. It has to be an iterative architecture. The solutions architecture needs to be iterative. The architecture should think beyond the MVP. It shouldn't just cater to the MVP and then change the entire architecture. Architect needs to think beyond MVP, delivery milestones, define the MVP 1, MVP 2, et cetera, right? The architecture needs to be futuristic. You should think about the futuristic technology selection. If you're thinking about a ESB that is not really catering to your need, that is not the right tool for you. If you don't think about containers now, maybe that's a problem for you. So those kind of futuristic decisions you have to take at the architecture level, so your architecture is much more flexible. And the architecture should be able to accommodate change. Your service integrator, your framework that you use should be able to accommodate more data types, more protocols, et cetera, so you are not blocked because of a technology selection that you did. And also, when it comes to deployment, the quality of services should define the deployment. It's not that you just want it in multiple data centers because you have multiple data centers. It has to be that these are the quality of services that we want in my application. I want my applications to have 4 nines of availability. So I'll do a multi-data center deployment. I'll cluster the API manager. I'll do a geo distribution, etc. So those kind of quality of services, high availability, redundancy, data replication, caching, those things you have to take into consideration when you're doing the deployment architecture. And deployment architecture can also be, it is iterative. I don't think any of the applications will hit million requests once it goes to production. There are some cases, but it is not the usual case. So in that case, you can roll out a minimalistic version of the deployment first and then slowly scale it out. So the architecture needs to support the scale out aspect, but you don't have to build the entire thing once, right? So that's also, again, relates to the MVP aspect. What is the minimum viable aspect of your delivery? Right, so we talked a lot. So are we done? That's the main thing. So I've worked with a lot of organizations where they have built a platform, which is a really cool thing. Like you are a central IT department or IT team. You want to facilitate all your teams. You want to get all your teams on board to a platform, right? So you do the technology selection correctly. You do the solutions architecture correctly. You choose the tools correctly. And then you deploy it finally and make it production. So you have a platform now. Is that what it takes? Like, are we done? I don't think that is the case. You have to do a lot of evangelism within your organization. In large organizations have lot of small business units. So there is a very human aspect of creating a platform. You need to market your platform. With not like fancy marketing terms, you need to, you know, like really take the platform to the developers and show them how you can leverage it. What is the advantage of that platform? If you write that application from scratch, what are the things that you need to look at? You have to do all your deployment. You have to maintain your deployment. You have to scale your deployment. We have created this really common platform. You don't have to do all those things. You concentrate on your business problem. You build your application. You use our APIs, onboard that application to the platform. I'm pretty sure like all those small business units will understand that value proposition. In order to convince all those teams, we had to think about all that other things that I talked about, the correct architecture, futuristic things, and things like that. Because often we see some teams push back because of a technology selection. They think, okay, that technology is not good. It's a dying technology. I don't want to be in that platform and get stuck in that platform. So getting the correct solutions architecture, getting the correct deployment architecture is the key to market your platform. So marketing your API platform. So the other thing that I have seen is putting an API store or an API front end is also a very good marketing tactic. Like it just reaches all the units. It just reaches all the business units. When you see something, when you see the API is working, people want to create something. People want to leverage it, right? But when you don't see it, then they will build their own thing. There are a lot of duplication of work, right? So that's why we think that API management or the API product is central to everything, right? So when you have that, it is easier to go to small business units and convince them. Tutorials, samples, case studies, talks helps a lot. Internal talks, a lot of lunch and learn sessions, etc. They will definitely help. Sponsored hackathons, like you can do quick hackathons, create some applications, et cetera, and partnerships, of course. So we have some experience with some of the customers that we have done this. We've done it with Fidelity. We have done it with one specific customer, Transport for London. It's a very successful case study. The London Transportation Service, they created a really cool common platform that can publish APIs, with the IoT data, et cetera. And they wanted to host a hackathon. So any application developer can come visit their API store, use those APIs, and build something cool. And they give a prize, et cetera. So there's that marketing aspect. And that platform is leveraged. And everybody knows that platform. And that's how you create the traction. So getting the technical stuff sorted is vital. But that is not enough. That's the whole point of it. There are really good platforms that got developed and just died because you didn't have that, you know, the long tail or the last mile. You didn't walk that last mile. So I think it is quite important. Finally, will there be a silver bullet? I don't think there is. So it is always iterative. You will do a lot of mistakes. Like yesterday we heard, like, if you want to go from point A to B, 90% of the time you have to correct your course. So it is a challenging journey. And I think if you have the correct strategy, if you deliver fast, if you write something quickly and deliver fast, you can easily course correct, do changes. If your enterprise or if your team is agile, you can easily correct things. So I think those will help in this journey. All right, so to summarize everything, I think APIs definitely walk the talk. APIs delivers the platform aspect. It shows you the strength of the platform. And if you want to build a common platform, APIs is the key thing that you have to consider. APIs give the intelligence in the consumer-driven market. So earlier we talked about the age of the consumer. APIs gives you the intelligence of what the consumer needs. If you know what APIs are getting hit very frequently during Black Friday season, et cetera, you know how to model your next application for the next Black Friday season. APIs give the visibility to your organization regardless of the size. If you are a startup, doesn't matter. If you're a large enterprise, doesn't matter. If you have a clean API, that's all you need. APIs encourage sharing and innovation. It's nothing new, so it definitely encourages innovation. All right, so that brings me end to the